The honeybee's story of existence is one of mutual benefit and contribution between its communities and with nature. Perhaps the survival of human communities is also dependent on creating synergies with systems that we are a part of. Limits, degradation, and breakdown. We need to change our track. Our buildings depend on energy sources like oil and gas to make indoor environments comfortable. But these conventional resources are running scarce. We must innovate ways in which buildings can make better use of the energy available. What if buildings and neighborhoods work together in harmony, connecting and sharing their different energy flows? The Center for Interactive Research on Sustainability, or CIRS, in Vancouver, British Columbia, is testing ways that this could be possible.
CIRS has been planned as a living laboratory for sustainability, where the main purpose of the research that takes place in it is to study not only the performance of the building and how it was planned and how it was constructed, how it was designed, but also all aspects of sustainability as they apply to the built environment.
CIRS was designed with four main energy sources in mind. The sun is harnessed through solar collectors on the roof that run a refrigerant through vacuum tubes of glass to capture heat for the building's hot water use, as well as with photovoltaic cells that convert sunlight into electricity. A geothermal exchange system uses a heat pump to extract heat from the ground below and then redistributes it into the building. The building itself is a source of energy through a series of heat recovery systems. And perhaps most innovative is a system that harvests waste heat from an adjacent building.
Earth and Ocean Sciences is a laboratory that has a high air changeover rate. So they're exhausting a lot of air, and with that exhaust air is a lot of exhausted heat.
Fume hoods safely ventilate air away from experiments in laboratories.
The volume of air is very large, and the temperature at which that air is being discharged into the atmosphere is about 20 degrees Celsius. So that was immediately identified as a big opportunity for harvesting heat for CIRS.
So the system captures some of that heat and is able to reuse it, taking it over to CIRS and using it as a thermal energy source.
That virtuous cycle can continue for many years. It establishes a symbiotic relationship between the two buildings, and it results in a net benefit to the university, which is reduced use of natural gas and lower CO2 emissions.
I'm looking at energy systems integration and looking at CIRS as a case study for having two buildings connected and possibly scale that up to the campus and neighborhood level.
Across our cities and campuses, there are a great many potential heat sinks and sources that could be tapped into.
Well, if you had everyone in the residences showering in the morning, you're going to have really large hot water use, and then instead of all of that energy just going down the drain, that could potentially be captured and then sent to the next place it was needed, whether it was offices and classrooms.
Ice rinks release a significant amount of waste heat from large compressors that refrigerate the surface. With the correct infrastructure in place, this waste heat could be harvested for other buildings to make use of. The knowledge and technology to make energy sharing possible currently exist. In theory, these systems make sense to conserve energy. But making this happen in reality is not that simple. People must learn how to adapt to new technologies, and experimentation helps us do that.
Well, I think a lot of issues arise just out of the fact that some of these things aren't being done, and there's a learning process to doing anything new. The performance numbers that we're getting out of the system are much lower than is expected.
CIRS is an experimental building that's able to test new energy technologies. Researchers have used energy models to explore why predicted versus actual energy use in CIRS is not the same.
There had been a model that's done in the pre-design stage, but it has some missing parts where real performance, real envelope cannot be depicted.
The ultimate goal is to have what we call predictive models. where the predictions are very close to reality. CIRS building is a unique case where we have measurements of lots of different parameters that contribute to the total energy consumption of the building. And then we can compare those parameters with the model estimation at different stages.
The mathematics behind future energy models can now be derived from better empirical evidence. This process allows for other potential energy sharing systems to integrate lessons from CIRS into their own planning and execution.
Really develop those algorithms and calculations and forecasts based on existing buildings, calibrate them, and then try using them on new buildings as they're being designed. There's also a feedback loop to those designers because they can see that those systems that they put in place, either they're not working as they intended or as they thought they were, or the building occupants aren't using them as they're intended.
When the time comes to test these systems, they actually work. And it's much more easier to review that when things are being built, whereas once everything's done and completed and you put drywall around it and you put walls around it, it's much more difficult to go and start digging holes to fix things.
A lot of it comes down to changing the mindsets of designers, of building operators, building users, to actually consider the impact that their decisions will have on the energy use in the building.
The goal of building science research is to take a hypothesis and make applications. This could be justifying a change in construction practices and codes, or laying a foundation to ask further questions.
How are we going to reduce the demand for municipal services? Because at the end of the day, it's all about reducing the demand at the building scale by spilling over benefits from the building into the community. The byproduct of one process can be used as feedstock for another process, and then you start interconnecting buildings and start creating symbiotic relationships.
What would building systems look like if they functioned like a holistic organism, creating harmony and synergies between different buildings and their users?
Notes working together makes a fuller sound. Having a system that has various components that are integrated into it and are able to work together and create something that is in a way more than the sum of its parts, because you have connections that are enabling different transfers. The buildings and different energy infrastructures would be part of a network.
I would say that's when you think about living systems, and that's when you try to create buildings that behave and that perform like living systems. We can maintain environmental integrity, and we can make building inhabitants happier, healthier, and more productive by changing the narrative, by changing the way in which we plan, design, build, and operate buildings.